So today we are going to discuss a very important topic, and that is the sedimentary basins. Broadly, the Earth's surface can be classified into two areas. One area is known as the area of accumulation, and the another area, that is the non-accumulation. So broadly, Earth surface or globe can be classified into two: the area of accumulation and the area of non-accumulation. This area of non-accumulation are the places where erosion is taking place, whereas the area of accumulation, they are the depressed part on the surface of the earth. They are the low-lying areas, they are the depressions, they are the geosynclines, they are the syncline, they are the trough, they are the gravens, where thick accumulation of sedimentation is taking place. So the area of accumulation, they are the depressions on the surface of the earth where thick accumulation of sedimentation is taking place, are known as sedimentary basins. So basically, sedimentary basins are depressions on very large scale. Sedimentary basins are morphotectonic depressions. So what are sedimentary basins? Sedimentary basins are morphotectonic depressions on the surface of the earth. They are the depressions which are very huge in size, where very thick accumulation of sedimentation is taking place. So if you just look at these two, the area of accumulation and the area of non-accumulation, means the area of deposition and the area of erosion, for this the most important process is the tectonic. Why tectonic? Because it is only because of the tectonic process that any flat region may be uplifted like this, and any flat region may be formed like a depression. So for thick accumulation of sedimentation, what processes are really required? Tectonics is very important, because it is only because of the tectonic process that the flat surface, they become uneven. At some places we are having high places, at some places we are having low lying areas. So the highland areas, the upland areas, are the areas of non-accumulation where erosion is taking place, and the low lying areas are the areas where deposition is taking place. And from where we are getting the sediments? We are getting the sediment from the upland region. So these two things, the area of accumulation and the area of non-accumulation, they are very important for a sedimentary basin. If you are having only area of accumulation and there are no uplifted land mass, from where the sediments will come? So the upland masses as well as the low-lying areas, they are very important for the formation of sedimentary basins. Earlier, or you can say that before the concept of sedimentary basins, because the sedimentary basins, that term was coined after the plate tectonic. Before that, there was another theory to explain the thick accumulation of sedimentation, and that theory was geosyncline. Hall, the name of scientist, and the Dana, they were the American scientists. They explained the formation of mountain building processes through geosyncline. They explained the thick accumulation of sedimentation through geosyncline. They explained the deformation in the mountainous region through geosyncline. In 1859, for the first time, Hala and Dana, they explained the theory of geosyncline. So before the concept of plate tectonic, or before the sedimentary basins were evolved, the geosynclinal theory was good enough, or that was the only theory to explain the formation of mountain. Mountain of Alps or Appalachian Mountain or the Himalayas, they were explained by the theory of geosyncline. But nowadays, the geosynclinal theory has been completely abandoned. It is obsolete. Why it failed? The geosynclinal theory failed to explain because that fails to explain the continuous upliftment and the continuous deformation, and that's why the geosynclinal theory was completely discarded. Later on, after the concept of plate tectonic, the sedimentary basins, they explain the formation of the mountains. Why? Because in the mountain we are getting thick accumulation of sediment, as well as in the sedimentary basins we are getting thick accumulation of sediments, and that's why sedimentary basins, they are the places of low-lying areas, they are the macro tectonic depressions where thick accumulation of sedimentation, thousands of meter sediments are being deposited. Second point is very important in the case of sedimentary basins. Sedimentary basins are known for continuous subsidence. Subsidence is a continuous process in a sedimentary basin, and because of this subsidence, continuously accommodation space is being generated into the sedimentary basins. So what are the various processes for subsidence in the sedimentary basin? Number one, stretching. Stretching. Second, thermal subsidence. And third, loading. So these three are important process of subsidence. Stretching is taking place. Automatically the crust will be thinner and there will be depressions. Thermal subsidence, if anything is becoming cold, if temperature is getting down, because of this low temperature the material will contract. Because of the contraction, the density will increase, and because of the increased density, a sag will be formed, a depression will be formed. Then the third is loading. Because of the overburden pressure, subsidence will take place. So these three are very important processes which are responsible for the subsidence of any sedimentary basins. Now if you look at the classification of sedimentary basin, the classification of sedimentary basin is basically based on plate tectonics. And in plate tectonics we know that there are two types of plates. Number one is continental plate and the second is oceanic plate. And there are three types of plate movement. Number one movement is divergent movement. Second movement is convergent movement. Third movement is strike slip movement. So there are three type of plate movements. Number one is divergent, when the plates are moving away from each other. This is also known as crustal extension. This is also known as spreading center. Second type of movement is convergent, when both the plates, they are coming towards each other. And the third is side by side movement or the strike slip movement. Again in divergent there are two types. In divergent there are two types. Number one, the sedimentary basins which are formed at are very close to the plate boundary. And second, if the sedimentary basins are formed on the crust, either continental crust or oceanic crust. So they are formed either between the crust or within the crust. So there are two types of sedimentary basin in the divergent, between the crust and within the crust. And the second is convergent, the third is strike shape movement, and the last is hybrid sedimentary basins. So there are five types. Hybrid means combination of any of the two, or miscellaneous we can say. So the sedimentary basins which are formed by divergent plate movement, the sedimentary basins which are formed by convergent plate movement, the sedimentary basins which are formed by divergent plate movement, the basins may be located either between the plates or within the plates. And in the convergent plate movement, again there are two situations, the subduction and the collision, and the strike slip movement, and the last is the hybrid sedimentary basins. Today we are going to discuss the sedimentary basins which are formed by divergent plate movement. Sedimentary basins which are formed by divergent plate movement. Divergent plate movement. This divergent plate movement means plates, they are moving away from each other. This is also known as crustal extension. This is also known as spreading center. So if someone is asking that explain the sedimentary basins which are formed by crustal extension, you will have to write down the sedimentary basins which are formed by divergent plate movement. If someone is asking that explain the sedimentary basins which are related with the spreading centers, you have to explain the sedimentary basins which are formed by divergent plate movement. So all these terms, the divergent plate movement, the crustal extension, as well as the spreading center, they are synonym. So the spreading center or the crustal extension or the divergent plate movement, how the sedimentary basins are formed? If this is the crust, now this is the point are the line through which extension is taking place, divergent plate movement is taking place. This part of the plate is moving in this direction and this part is moving in this direction. Both are moving away from each other. As soon as the plate will start this type of movement, that the plates, they are moving away from each other, what will form? A rift will be formed. A rift will be formed. This will be like this. This part is going up, this part is also going up, this part is going down, this part is going down. A rift is formed. Now this is the rift. What is this? This is Horst. What is this? This is Graben and this is Horst. So upland areas are Horst, the depressions are Graben. So in this rift valley, what is going on? That they are basically the basin, the graben, the depressed area, the low-lying areas, they are basically bounded on both the sides by what? They are bounded by extensional fault, by narrow faults. So the rift valleys are the first form sedimentary basins which are formed during divergent plate movement. when the one block is going up, another block is going down, again one block is going up, another block is going down. So it means if there are four blocks, first, second, third and fourth, this block is going up, this block is going down, this block is going up, this block is going down. If this is fifth, this block is going up. As a result, what will be formed? It will be formed like this. So these are the grievance, second part, and these are the host. And what are these? This is going up and this is going down. These are the extensional fault, these are the normal fault. So what is the main characteristic feature of a rift valley? That the post sedimentary basins which are formed by divergent plate movement, they are known as rift basins. Rift basins are the low-lying areas which are formed during divergent plate movement. They are the gravens and they are bounded by normal faults, by extensional faults. So this is one point, that how they are originated, how they evolved, how they form. Number second, I have discussed always in my sedimentary class that for deposition or for the formation or for any sedimentation, we need two things. Number one, from where we are getting the sediments, and second, what are the processes which are responsible to transport the sediments and to deposit the sediment. So from where we are getting the sediment from the adjacent blocks. Hosts are there, they will provide the sediments. And from what are the processes which are responsible for the transportation of sediments? The processes are, number one, aeolian processes, wind. Second process, they transport the sediments, the rivers, they will originate and they will deposit sediment, fluvial sediments. And third, when water will be deposited in this, the third process is lacustrine process. So the three most important processes which transport the sediments and deposit the sediment into the rift basin are, number one, aeolian process, second, fluvial process, and third, lacustrine process. So these are the processes, and they will produce the sediments and they will deposit the sediment. They will produce the sediment from the adjacent blocks and they will deposit the sediments into the graben. The present day example of rift basin is the Gulf of Suez. Gulf of Suez is the, and East African Valley is also very good example of this rift basins. So rift basins are the first basins which are formed by divergent plate movement. I hope that it is clear to all of you. Now the second basin, because the divergent plate movement is taking place, this is the crust and this is the spreading center and divergent plate movement is. The first sedimentary basins which are formed are the rift basin. With further movement, because this plate is moving in this direction, this is moving in this direction, this is moving in this direction, this is moving in this direction. With further movement, a basin will be formed. That basin is known as proto-oceanic trough. Proto-oceanic trough. Now what will happen? How this proto-oceanic trough will be formed? This proto-oceanic crust will be formed because this basin is moving, this part of the crust is moving in this direction, this is moving in this direction. With further movement, the crust will be very thin. With further movement, from the divergent center, from the spreading center, the crust will be very thin because the plates, they have already moved away from each other. And as soon as the crust will be very thin, the magma lying below the surface of the earth, that will come out. It means proto-oceanic trough or the basins in which at the base with what we are getting? We are getting basaltic flow. Because this plate is moving in this direction, this plate is moving in this direction, with further thinning of the crust, the magma will come out. The basaltic flow will take place. It means within this normal extensional fault on both the sides, what we will get at the base? We will get basaltic flow at the base. What we will get? We will get basaltic flow at the base. So the sedimentary with further movement of the rift valley, rift basins, the magma will come on the surface. Basaltic flow will take place, which are bounded by extensional fault, normal faults. And this type of sedimentary basin is known as proto-oceanic trough. It means in the proto-oceanic trough, what we are getting? In the proto-oceanic trough, what we are getting? We are getting the marine sediments. The igneous sediments will be there. From both the block sediments will come, and the process will be marine process. And the present example of this proto-oceanic trough is the Red Sea. Red Sea is the present example of this proto-oceanic trough. If this rift basin is forming, I am talking about the continental crust. If the crust are oceanic, then this rift basin will be maritime basin. That will be maritime, means that will be marine in nature. The rift basin will be marine in nature. And at that time, what process will operate? No fluvial, no lacustrine, no eolian. Because they will operate only if the spreading is taking place in the continental crust. But if the spreading is taking place in the oceanic crust, then the rift basin will be maritime rift basin, marine rift basin, and in that situation, waves, tides, they will operate into this rift basin. But that will be applicable only when the spreading is taking place in oceanic crust. Then the third type of basin is known as intracratonic basin. Intracratonic basin. Intracratonic basin. Now this is the situation. This was the crust. Now this is the spreading center. It is moving in this direction. It is in moving time. The first sedimentary basin which was formed was like this part is going up, this part is going down, this part is going up, this part is going down. This was rift basin. The second part, this was proto-oceanic trough. The second was, you can further thin out the crust. The second is proto-oceanic trough. Now this plate is again moving in this direction. This is in this direction. This one is in this direction. This one is in this direction. It means a time will come when this basin will be, this part will be far away from the spreading center. Now here is the, in this situation here is the spreading center, in this situation here is the spreading center, in this situation here is the spreading center. Now this part A, that is located far away from the spreading center. This is the spreading center point A. In this, this is A. In this, this is A. And in this, this is A. Now this point B is located much away from the A. There is change in the thermal regime. This point A is the spreading center. This point A is the spreading center. This point A is the spreading center. Here the crust is very thin. It means point A is hot or cold. Point A is hot because it is very close to the molten magma. Point A is hot. This point was also hot because it was also very close to the spreading center. Now this point has moved up to this place, and now this point has moved up to this place. It means this part of the crust B is located much away from the spreading center. Once it was very close to the spreading center. When it was close to the spreading center, when this point B was close to the spreading center, the temperature was high or low? Temperature was high. But now it has moved much away from the spreading center, and because of this movement much away from the spreading center, there is change in the thermal regime. Now this point B is not hot, but it is cold. And because of this change in the thermal regime, the density will increase, the volume will decrease. As a result, the density will increase, the weight will increase. And because of the increase in the weight, a thermal subsidence will take place and a basin will be formed. This basin is known as intracratonic basin. Intracratonic basin. How it is formed? This is formed because of the thermal subsidence. It means this basin will be very shallow. And if basin is very shallow, and if that is located on the plate, intraplate, if that is located on the plate, within the plate, as I introduced in the beginning, that in the divergent there are two types, between the plates and within the plates. So this is formed within the plate, and this is known as intracratonic basin. It is very shallow basin, and the most important processes are Lacus-Schrine processes. No doubt from the surrounding regions rivers will also drain into this, but the Lacus-Schrine process is the most important process. And the present day example of this basin is in Africa, and the name of the basin is Chad basin. Chad basin. It is located in Africa. Chad basin has, so what will the source of sediment? The adjoining sediments, they will be transported by various rivers. They will drain into this basin. So this Chad basin has reduced its size 10 times since Pleistocene time. Since Pleistocene, the Chad basin has reduced to 10 times in the size, because of the various region, because of supply of enormous supply of sediment, it has reduced its size. Now with further movement from the spreading center, a new basin will form, and this is known as passive margin. Passive margin. Passive margins are contrary to the active margins. Means those margins which are not active, they are known as passive margin. The east coast of India is a passive margin. The west coast of India is a passive margin. The east coast of America, that is in the Atlantic Ocean, that is a very good example of passive margin. So the Atlantic Ocean, which is in contact with the North America, that is very good example of passive margin. they are not active, that's why they are known as passive margin. And geomorphologically, passive margins, they include the continental shelf and continental slope. Geomorphologically, passive margins include the continental shelf and slope. And the most important example are the Atlantic Ocean, which is in contact with the North America. Then, with further extension, a new sedimentary basin will be formed, and that is the biggest or the largest ocean water bodies. They are the oceans, for example, Pacific Ocean. With further spreading of the proto-oceanic trough, with further spreading, a largest water body will be formed. The biggest water body will be formed. That will be the largest size of the sedimentary basin on this planet Earth, and they are known as oceans, such as Pacific Ocean. So, we know that in the Pacific Ocean, each and every type of process will operate, the shallow marine process as well as the deep marine process. The deltaic process will operate on the coastal region. The wave and tides, they will also operate on the coastal region. So, these are various sedimentary basins, such as rift basin, proto-oceanic trough, intratectonic basin, passive margin, and the oceans, which are formed by divergent plate movement, either within the plates or between the plates. So, this is all about the sedimentary basins. Thank you.